So let's start with a little table setting. And Commissioner Hochschild, can you describe sort of the current state of play? What CEC is doing with EPIC, with SCHIP, and other state efforts around funding and targeting innovation in the energy space?
Yeah, well, first of all, I'm still thinking about your Silicon Valley of weed comment in Colorado. I think at a certain point, you know, your entrepreneurial drive may get. let me just say, it's actually, this year is the 40th anniversary of the Energy Commission. I just want to take a second to set some context and pay tribute to the folks who kind of got us where we are. Because 40 years ago, California actually, first of all, the governor was a guy by the name of Jerry Brown, had taken over from a Republican movie star at that time, Ronald Reagan, so some things are not so different. And we were faced with a major challenge, which was load was growing at 8% a year. The legislature commissioned this report, the Command Corporation did, you know, what to do. And their answer was construct 40 nuclear plants along the coast. So we have an 800-mile coastline, that's a nuclear plant every 20 miles along the coastline. The legislature said, no, we're going to go a different direction. We're going to get serious about conservation, alternatives, et cetera. In the country, the Energy Commission was born really for that purpose, for appliances and buildings, invested, you know, over $1 billion in R&D on renewables. And where we are today, we have one nuclear plant, not 40. We are using half the energy per capita compared to the rest of the country. And we have the largest wind project in the world, the Alta Wind Energy Center. We have the largest thin film PV project, desert sunlight being built, largest crystalline PV project being built, largest geothermal power plant in the world. Really in every category, more new solar homes than anywhere else in the world. The largest manufacturing facility in the state of California is an electric car factory. Tesla was successful. So huge success story, and I think just we should all be expansive in terms of what we think is possible here. We're at a similar juncture today as we transition to a cleaner energy future. The Energy Commission has given away more money than we've ever done this year. It's about $800 million. We had up to $9 million. The EPIC program, about $140 million for research and development. I think one of the most exciting things that we're focused on with financing, I'll just talk briefly about two programs I think are the most exciting that are happening in renewable finance. The first is the PACE program. So this was born in Berkeley, 2008. The federal government, Freddie Mac said, you can't do it, the risk is too high. For those of you not familiar with the program, the idea is very simple. You can do an efficiency upgrade in your house. It's repaid through your property taxes. If you move out of the house, the loan stays with the home. California set aside $10 million as a loan loss reserve fund to essentially remove the risk for other lien holders. And this year really is when it's actually taking off. So we have so far 10,000 homes that have done an energy efficiency upgrade with the PACE program. Not a single default in the entire state. And we're very optimistic. And about half the state today lives in a territory where the PACE program is implemented. So I'm very bullish on that. We have 7.5 million homes in the state. If you think about the potential to do upgrades and why people don't do them, this is, I think, a big barrier buster. On the public sector side, there's a very exciting program, the ECA program, the Energy Conservation Assistance Act, which just gives essentially very low interest loans, 1% loans, for public buildings to do upgrades. We've done almost 1,000 buildings, again, not had a single default. And so I think this is, what you want in the market is many options, like a sort of topest platter of options, and we know there are two of them, but there's also on-bill financing, these kind of things that can really drive the market. The technology has come down in cost. Solar panels have come down 98% in price since 1980. So solar panels cost $35 a watt in 1980. It's 65 to 70 cents a watt today. The challenge is really financing challenges. Good work.
Excellent. And so in terms of, you mentioned the EPIC program, and you've been funding R&D for a long time, and sort of the early stage efforts and the pre-commercialization efforts. But can you talk just a little bit about what the CEC offers in that?
Yeah, so that's about $140 million a year, and it's for all kinds of technologies, efficiency and renewables. For example, the very first rooftop commercial project technology that without roof penetration was funded by an Energy Commission R&D grant at the time. It was Power Guard, and that got acquired by SunPower. And so there's examples of like that getting to market. Electric vehicle infrastructure, and it's really a full suite of technology. GM. And the woman who runs that program, I don't know if she's in, I'd say Laurie Tenhope, is absolutely terrific. She will be here earlier today, for those of you who haven't met her. But we're really excited about this. And it's going to be, as I said, about $1.3 or $4 billion over the next decade we're going to be giving away.
David, you have launched a number of companies, helped to grow a number of companies, invested in companies in California that have been transformative. So what is the mix in California in terms of the innovation life cycle, in terms of the availability of capital from both private and public sources? What is it about that has led to the success of so many things that you've been?
First important ingredient is just the policy goals get set at a time that's fairly early in the stage of technical development and the industry development. And in California, they've been large and they've been bold. And so when you're addressing an opportunity, you want to make sure there's a big market. California has always set very large objectives, so that's been one of the critical ingredients in my thinking anyways. And then typically I try to get involved at a fairly early stage of an industry cycle and find a big problem and try and solve it and make it easier. And so access to financing for solar, which is where I started, and now storage, was a big problem when we started. There was no one that wanted to talk to us. We would answer questions like, what happens if the sun doesn't shine? And we'd try to convince them they had larger problems than our financing, if that was the case. But what helped us get past all that was, in California anyways, was the early rebate program and then the initiatives that were put in place to basically help the industry grow up and drive the cost down over a period of time so that now the industry can stand on its own two feet without any initiatives. And as an investor, I really make that a hallmark of my strategy. If I can't see a strategy to where the company can survive without the programs in place, then I rarely have an interest. So I think the fact that California is bold in the beginning, supports it for a period of time, and then tails off those incentives so the industry is forced to be sustainable on its own is why I think California is such a great place to invest in.
Adam, you're in the midst of this. You've got a new technology, new application. From your perspective, I guess, walk us through both the focus on how you're approaching, you know, public programs like SCHIP, like EPIC, as well as sort of how those play into the larger capital stack that's required that you know can attract private equity investment and ultimately debt.
Yeah, so we're currently entirely venture funded. We've been going for about 4 years. We recently won a CEC award to help demonstrate our product at a customer site next year. So we're utilizing that funding to help minimize the risk on the customer side, bring down the cost so they can see the return that they need to feel comfortable with the first of a kind brand new technology. And with regard to SCHIP, so SCHIP is Self-Generation Incentive Program. It helps provide an incentive for DG technologies to help to reduce the cost for customers. Our technology is kind of a new technology. It wasn't around when all these programs were started. So we offer the same benefits as high efficiency and low emissions as a fuel cell, but we're not technically a fuel cell. So one of the problems we face is as we try to come to market is we don't fit anywhere in legislation. So we're on the outside looking in and trying to gain access to these programs that have helped companies grow. Bloom Energy is a great example. I have over 1,000 employees in California. And we're on that trajectory, but we don't have the same advantages. But the programs in California are probably top in the country from what we've seen in terms of helping early technologies get through the valley of death. And that's one of the reasons why we're based in Silicon Valley, not only for the engineering talent, but also because it's a great marketplace. Our customers are very knowledgeable and willing to take chances on new technologies. And you know, both on the energy savings, but also for the PR value.
Excellent. And I want to come back to that, but I'll loop Dan into the discussion first. But Dan, you and I have talked a number of times, and we've heard
both about some of the SCHIP and EPIC, and then as well as the ECA loan programs and some of the other things. From the perspective of folks who are sort of approaching this, they've got a new technology, they've got a new business model, and they're working to develop it in California. How do they know sort of where to go? Are there pathways to connect with the programs that are available right now?
Well, I'd say that it's harder than it should be, particularly given a little bit of context around where the private venture funds and private capital is for innovation. I had a chance yesterday to go down to Menlo Park for the Green Tech Media Next Wave Clean Energy Investment Conference. I had a chance to speak there. I do have a day job, and I occasionally do it, but it was just a unique experience. And there's a lot of concern about the inability of traditional venture funds to get formed. There is a dearth of capital for early stage innovation, really energy innovation period, at any stage of its development. If you have money as a private investor, it's a great time to be in the market because the scarcity of capital is putting good valuations from the investor's perspective. That puts more pressure on the public funding opportunities. And it's an opportunity, frankly, for California with the most robust early stage innovation finance program in the country, maybe even comparable to what the federal government is doing on certain levels, to really optimize what it's offering. There's too much overlap. It's too bureaucratic, even though from the inside, and I spent a fair amount of time a decade ago inside the PUC trying to make these programs make sense to investors and entrepreneurs. It can look sensible from the inside, but when you're a young company and you have scarce resources, the first hire is not going to be a public relations professional. If you have one, that is probably going to be the first fire when you're running out of money. So we have to create a streamlined way for, say, a green bank in California to look like one entity to the entrepreneurial community. If you come into the green bank's virtual presence, you should be routed to whatever program fits your needs best. It doesn't matter if it's the Energy Commission or the Air Resources Board or iBank or CAIDFA. It should look like one point of interface so that a busy decision maker, underfunded and pulled in a number of different directions, can easily understand what the program is, get a quick no if that's the outcome. Long no's are deadly. They're probably worse than a quick yes in a lot of cases. So just make it obvious what the offering is. Be entrepreneurial as a state. Match the entrepreneurial energies of the private sector, and I think we can really make good use of these funds. Mm-hmm.
To your point that equity investors are equity investments pretty scarce. David, you and I spoke last night, and you're actually finding sort of more success in the project finance space than in the equity space in certain circumstances. Is this a temporary thing where things will even out as the sort of rates of return or the dollars available? It'll just play itself out, or is there a role for those of us in public policy to be working to sort of bridge the needs in a better way than we have been to date?
I don't know the answer whether it's temporary or permanent, but I know as long as it takes 9 months for 10 guys to create $5 billion of value at Snapchat or whatever the latest social media one is, the capital is really focused there. And so when you walk into a venture firm now and say, we have a great new clean technology, but it actually takes some R&D and some investment, they're polite, but you're pretty much shown the door right now. And that's okay. They've got higher and better uses for their money. But it does create an opportunity, I think, for the state to be a little more aggressive in funding those early stage opportunities that have potentially big impact, because there isn't a lot of other sources. And I think the mindset that you have to have, which the venture firms all have, is that some of these are going to be miserable failures, but that's okay. You just make that part of your thinking and your program so that if a cylinder happens, it's okay, yeah. Right? That's part of the process, and you emphasize the positive and the opportunities that you can help.
Commissioner, I'll let you respond to that too, but I also want to put another thought on the table, and that is we've seen some areas where public policy has absolutely been transformational. CSI is probably the example cited around the country, not just in California, of a program that gave certainty, that allowed investors to take the long view, knew exactly what they were going to get, had a downward slope that forced ultimately the industry to to get more competitive and ultimately to stand on its own 2 feet. As you're thinking about the programs that are administered by CEC specifically, state government more generally, is there that sort of a focus to how you connect to private markets, how the market signals that you're creating ultimately lead to the attraction of private investment in the sector?
Yeah, so great question. So let's just talk for a second about the California Solar Initiative, because this is kind of, from my perspective, this is the poster child for how policy should work. So in many ways, it was a Republican governor, Democratic legislatures in 2006 that got this adopted. So bipartisan from the get-go, and it was a long-term policy, 10 years, $3 billion, 3,000 megawatt program, and the idea was to take solar and make it mainstream and be able to stand alone. And so where are we today? It started, you know, really the incentive started in 2007, and today it's a 10 step program. We're basically in step 10, and in a good chunk of the state it's already finished. So 50% of the solar that got installed today, we have about roughly, we're coming up on 300,000 rooftop PV systems. So 50% of the systems that got installed in 2014 were installed with no incentive at all in areas that say where the incentive's gone, and the market is healthy. So that's how it should work. And the reason that works is it just provides this level of certainty to investors like David and others that they can make a long bet, and this industry is going to be here. So when you're involved in Sun Edison and Sunrun and these other leaders in the market, you know, you feel comfortable doing that because you know there's a long-term stable policy that's predictable. And prior to that, there had been very episodic kind of stop-start policies, and that doesn't work. So I think that's the general principle. I do want to talk for a second about Solyndra, because I feel, you know, that example got used so much and became, I think it actually chilled the entire clean energy space for mm-hmm. 2 years. And it obscured all the other, you know, successes. Tesla, by the way, you know, got the same size loan, okay, almost exactly the same size loan, $500 million, repaid it in its entirety 9 years early, and now they're the largest manufacturer in the state. They employ 6,000 people, and they're growing. And they're on path to do a $35,000 electric car that goes 200 miles on a charge by 2016, right? I mean, that's that success is much more significant than a Solyndra. And, of course, all the large-scale projects I mentioned in the beginning, many of those were funded by the same loan guarantee program. So I think we need to guard against being too risk-averse because a single company fails. That is actually something you should expect in a portfolio. And I would even argue if you have no failures, you're not taking the kind of risk that you need to. You know, that's actually part of our job. I just want to come back to one point Adam made about, you know, how you said there's kind of not a space in a way for your company. I think this is a big challenge of policy kind of has to chase technology. And, you know, we have, for example, the state legislature today, 40% of the legislators are new. Okay, so they know, you know, they're just starting from scratch, and you know, certainly the Energy Commission, a third of our staff is new in the last 3 years, and so this, you know, having forums like this where there's opportunity to exchange ideas and developments is actually a critical priority, because you don't make good decisions if you don't know the latest developments, and so it's definitely an area you need.
Yeah, and Adam, this was the point that I actually wanted to come back to you on, and you know, as to your point, we're always sort of chasing what the technology is, as opposed to, you know, oftentimes you see on the other side taking bets on technology that isn't. And so how do we construct public policy, especially public finance programs, so that as new technologies are brought to market or as new ways of using existing technologies are applied in new ways through innovative business models, how do we construct it so that it is sort of inclusive as opposed to, you know, restrictive by definition? And I'd ask both of you, I guess, that question.
Yeah, I think that's a great question. And I think it could come from, so I'm an engineer, and you can't really solve a problem unless you know the problem that you're trying to solve. You got to start with a problem statement. So I think the state, with all there's so many programs that the state has, and it's not necessarily clear what the objectives of those programs are. So I think setting out clearly what the objectives are, setting out the performance standards that meet those objectives, and then letting whatever technology meets those performance objectives apply for that program, rather than saying, you know, these are the technologies today, I'm going to set the objectives based on that. I think forward-looking, just setting what the objective is, and then letting anyone compete, apply.
So to make it specific, if the objective, which is defining a lot of where investment is flowing right now, is around GHG reduction goals and using AB32 dollars for intended purposes. And obviously, a number of programs are not funded through AB32. But if that's the sort of broad objective, you'd say if you can meet an emissions profile, if you can meet a carbon reduction profile using existing technologies or one that you're helping to develop, then you're eligible.
Yes, and if that is the main driver of the program, if it is GHG reductions in state. Even though it's a global problem, if that is the goal, then set it based on California. Whatever metric the Air Resources Board or the CEC determines, I think that makes the most sense rather than picking and choosing technologies.
Dan, you mentioned Green Bank, and Commissioner Hochschild, you have talked about the role of sort of taking chances on riskier technologies. In a number of places around the country, when you look at Connecticut, when you look at New York, when you look at Hawaii, they've been focused very much on deployment of known technologies, that this is about getting to scale as opposed to investing in what's new. It obviously takes a different investment calculus when you're looking at earlier stage technologies. How do you square that? How do you do both, or is it that you really need to choose between one and the other?
I think we have to get more sophisticated as a public sector on the financial techniques that are used to support this industry. You see the corollary to that going on in private investment. The blunt instrument of venture capital, these large funds were raised over the last decade, approaching $1 billion, and that venture capital got used to scale a lot of these technologies in ways that were not appropriate for what the underlying venture returns thesis requires. So when you see a company like BrightSource, whom I greatly respect and know very well, having to use venture capital money to build their first power plant, that destroys the venture proposition. It might make the company improve its technology, but it's going to alienate a lot of limited partner investors because they're not going to get the returns on that money they expected. So what's happening now in the private capital community is a differentiation around the thesis. You're seeing family offices rise with slightly more patient approaches to the allocation of equity. You're seeing a better utilization of bond finance. The loan guarantee theme has been proven. The Solyndra case has been disproven as the the real learning from that program with 95%+ success rate. So the private capital community, while it's still underfunded, there's a differentiation and diversification of the themes that they're using to raise money, and that's going to come back in and help innovation finance. You have to make sure that the marketplace for these various underlying innovations is in place. Mm-hmm. If you can't see a path to deployment, risk capital is not going to come in. So that brings back the question of, well, what's the public sector's role in all this? Some folks, in looking at reform of public capital for clean tech, want to say, let's make it all low-cost loans. I think that's a mistake, even low-cost loans and loan guarantees. There has to be a role for grants. They could be converted into equity. There could be a conversion point into debt. Public sector doesn't think very well along those lines. Private investors get a little skittish when they see a role of government in overseeing an investment in the long run. So if we're going to do grants, let's focus on grants with an outcome. And one way that I've been encouraging folks to think about it in our investment arena and in this political conversation is identify a metric in consultation with the private capital community that this company needs to hit before it is eligible for a seed stage venture investment, and make that the milestone that your public grant dollar is driving the company towards. You'll have a clear path towards the next stage financing. You can report on that to the political bodies that want to see the results of these funds. And it's a very clear mention to the entrepreneur, this is why we're giving you this money. We're not just expecting you to come back in 24 months with a PowerPoint presentation and vaguely speak to the number of jobs created. It's a technological question. We're going to give you basically non-dilutive capital, but there's a very specific thing we expect you to achieve, because private capital is saying that's what you need to do to get their money.
Mm-hmm. And Commissioner, I want to ask you, I promise, David, I'll come back to you. I've got a great one for you. But on that specific point, how does that reality that sort of is being dealt with in the private sector, or how private sector investment, how does that square with sort of the administration of these programs and as a commissioner, how realistic is that? Is it doable?
So I think it is, and some of the things we've already put in place. For example, the technology I cited, the first commercial rooftop PV system, which was funded by an Energy Commission R&D grant, we actually got, it was a $350,000 grant to a company based in the Bay Area, PowerLight at the time, and we got royalties from that. So we ended up getting $1.5 million in royalties, and the technology took off, and then we put that money back into more R&D grants. So I think royalties are actually a great part of the equation. But this is difficult work to do. It's also, there's not that many people in this part of the Energy Commission, for example, who come out of the technology space. And so the expertise, you know, and the ability to assess, and frankly, even, you know, experts have a hard time, you know, really judging, you know, what technology is going to take off. So it's a very tricky business. And I think, you know, to me, I mean, Dan, I think Dan's very much on the right path, but we also have to be just comfortable with some level of failure and understand that the portfolio will succeed, but there are going to be failures, and that is part of what we should expect. It shouldn't be something that's going to upset the apple cart when it happens.
And from an optics messaging, you know, political reality, I mean, how do you tell that story to a public that sort of, you know, is sort of wants to jump on examples of government waste, or for those who are opposed for one reason or another to these programs from the get-go?
Yeah, we have to tell the success story. I mean, let me ask you a question. This is what I just mentioned of Tesla getting the same size loan as Solyndra did and repaying it 9 years early. Raise your hand if you knew that fact. Okay, so this is pretty sophisticated. All right, so that's about half, okay? But everybody would have known about Solyndra. And in actually most audiences I go to, nobody's heard that about Tesla. And so the success stories don't get told widely, nearly as widely as the failures. And that's just a communications challenge.
Let me jump in very, very quickly, because it goes to the point of using the right investment technique as a public sector investor for the problem in front of you at the moment. Loan guarantees have a role for technologies that are commercializable and are going to have revenue. But if you want to apply a loan guarantee to a pre-commercial technology, you're that's a prescription for trouble, because the loan guarantee necessitates the provision of private debt. No private lender in their right mind is going to put debt into a company that doesn't have a path to revenue. Mm-hmm. And no company that doesn't have a path to revenue should take debt.
Right.
So we have to get more sophisticated about the techniques we use at the stage of technological development. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a great point. David, and I don't mean to simply be asking questions, so feel free to jump in on each other's answers, but David, when we think about the public sector's role in supporting these things, often it's in places like we'll provide grants, or we'll provide loan guarantees or low-cost loans. Sometimes it's in, you know, clear market signals with mandates and that sort of thing. I think more recently you're starting to see a focus sort of on the flip side of the equation, that actually it's government that's standing in the way. And from sort of an entrepreneurial perspective, you take a company like Uber, outside the energy space, and they're saying, we've got this business model, and it's ready to go. It's being embraced by consumers. Every place we roll it out, it's successful, except when it gets basically killed by government regulations. So, in the financing perspective, as you're looking sort of beyond 2020 to 2050, and you know that there are new technologies, and you know, what is the role, both in government, of providing the necessary supports, but also getting out of the way or having a regulatory framework that actually allows companies that are doing innovative new things to be able to go forward without too much interference?
That's a big question.
I told you I had a good one for you.
I don't know if I have the exact answer, except I think that if the policy goals are clear, whether it's carbon reduction or renewable portfolio standard, that you just have to hang in there against all the objections, because a lot of these shifts, whether it's energy or in the case of Uber transportation, there's going to be a regulatory backlash at some point in time, because eventually you're affecting regulated entities' business, and they're going to do what they should do, which is fight back and try to protect their turf. And so I think as a regulator and a governmental entity, you just have to remain consistent and steadfast that is your goal, so that the businesses that are in the industry know that there's going to be battles and there's going to be problems and there's going to be compromises, but in the long run, we're all trying to meet the same objective. And that's probably not a very specific answer, but there's so many specific problems when you get into these transformations of industries that I'm probably not smart enough to answer them all.
I think, you know, one way to think about it, I think there's sort of three classes, you could argue, of technology development. The first, let's say, you know, Google and Facebook and Twitter and Apple and all these companies that are developing technologies related to the internet that are essentially totally unregulated and don't need to be regulated. I mean, there's no public safety you know, issue there. The second would be, you know, say, like Airbnb and Uber, where they're kind of coming up against some regulatory necessity to charge a tax if you're taking passengers to the airport or have some hotel tax, right? But the third, really, for energy, it's a highly regulated space. And that is actually not going to change because you have public safety issues. You have to keep the grid going. The utilities are regulated monopolies. I mean, and innovation in that space is much harder because of that. You're operating in participate, for example, in the California Solar Initiative. You know, I was in the solar industry at that time. I wrote, 29 filings on, the design of that program. It's very heavy. Participation is required to get the policies right, and you can't be in the market if the policy's not right. And so, and that's just that's not going to change. I mean, energy is going to stay heavily regulated, and that's right. Just a foundation.
Yeah, you wanted to jump in.
Right. Yeah, and to that point, I mean, I think whatever you're going to try to finance, whether it's early stage, late stage, it kind of needs to be a holistic approach. You can't ignore the regulatory side. And I think there are several instances where programs conflict with regulation. And so you're actually funding right now a CHP project. We'll get money from SCHIP. That dollar amount doesn't make up for the amount of extra equipment to even participate in that program. Mm-hmm. So people aren't utilizing it. Mm-hmm. So there's kind of needs to be a holistic approach. There's also regulatory issues that right now solar NEM is at the PUC. They have to make up NEM 2.0 by 2017. If that changes significantly, where a lot of the incentives go away, a lot of the solar deals might flip upside down if they're not grandfathered in. So I think if we're going to fund late stage through a grants program, we also have to make sure that the regulations stay in line with what we're trying to do.
This goes to a point that David made earlier about the turnover in the legislative community and the need to educate them about how important the regulatory process is and the appointment of commissioners. AE does a great job of highlighting PUCs around the country and the role that they play. But it's a small community that really understands these dynamics. And if you don't get the right people in positions of leadership that prioritize innovation, the right amounts of industrial change in these regulated industries, then they deserve to be regulated for certain reasons. But you have to have a culture of innovation, and that has to start at the decision-making level. And if you don't have a legislature overseeing that process that really gets that, you could wind up on the wrong side of that five-person voting body. And when I was in the commission, it was great. All you had to do was count to three, and you could get the votes you needed. But it tips one way or another on a knife edge, and you could wind up on the wrong side. Yeah.
I think another thing from an entrepreneur's perspective that you can do in the early stages before the regulatory framework is set in place and the compromises have been cut is self-regulate. Make sure you're setting standards that you can be proud of so that when the regulatory discussion inevitably comes up, you've got some information, you've got some history of being a good corporate citizen, helping whatever the public policy goal is, so that you're ahead of the curve when you get to the point of either being large enough that you're going to face opposition or just policy opposition.
Excellent. I want to open it up to questions from the audience, and as you're starting to think of questions, I'll ask one more. And that's to Dan. We've talked about this. To Commissioner Hochschild's point about there are these three sort of buckets. They're, unregulated because there's no concern. There's sort of light regulation and heavy regulation. One area when you get sort of out of the power sector but into the transportation sector that I've heard a number of concerns for is, we've got goals in California and we can see our way from 2020 to 2035 and have a sense about where we're going. But it's less clear and the market signals are less clear in the transportation sector, which is, frustrates investment from the private sector. I'd love your thoughts on that, or prescriptions, or what do you think is getting in the way, if you agree?
Well, I do agree, and I think I've bored you enough with my thoughts on it that I think you knew I agreed. There's an absence of the equivalent of the regulatory compact in the fuel sector. I'd love to think that we could institute a regulatory compact, meaning we basically carve up the market for industrial incumbents to provide transportation services. Absent that, it's an interesting thought exercise to use the utilities as an alternative champion and really extend the regulatory compact from electric and gas utilities into the transportation sector and give them a license to compete for our transportation dollar. I think that's a viable path for California and could be a potential cure to the utility death spiral in a lot of ways, not just electricity, hydrogen fuels, natural gas, et cetera. I think there's a role for public investment using a green bank. If we're going to succeed in keeping fuels under the cap, which I believe we will, redeploying those fuels-related proceeds from maybe 32 to build the critical infrastructure that reaches the consumer, sends a signal to private investors that if you develop advanced biofuels, they will reach the marketplace. That sends a signal to the OEMs to build the underlying machines that will use that fuel, and will defeat the argument that there's no consumer demand for this stuff. The oil incumbency makes arguments on both sides of the equation. One, that it's too expensive and there's no demand for it, but that undercuts all initiatives to stimulate the demand that does exist and make it stronger. So we need a multifaceted strategy, and absent that, if we don't solve the transportation piece, which is frankly more than 50% of the state's greenhouse gas emissions now, we talk about it as about 40, but the electricity burden that goes into the production and refining of fuels adds another 10%. And as we shrink the stationary source, that number pro rata is going to be ever bigger over time. So we're not really even in the conversation on transportation yet, and we have to take it much more seriously.
Let's open it up. Questions from the audience.
Right here. I'm curious what the panel thinks of crowdsourced funding, and is it a sideshow? Is it going to be meaningful? You know, what's the future? 5 years from now, is it a big deal or not?
There was a lot of talk of it yesterday down in Menlo Park. I think it's finding its footing in terms of deployment for proven technology. SolarCity acquired a platform, Common Assets, to basically crowdfund for certain solar assets. It makes a lot of sense when there's no technology risk. It gives me a lot of heartburn to think about the money that could be lost and the small investors that could get seriously damaged if there is an uncurated marketplace for emerging technology. That's going to give a lot of black eyes for the small investors' perspective on how clean tech is evolving. But once we compartmentalize it and say, we know this stuff works, there's a local project, you can see it operating, you can feel good about it at the community level, and you can vote with your dollars, I think there's a good story. Is it going to be multi-billions over the next 5 years? Probably not, but it's going to make a meaningful public perception impact, I would say.
Adam, is it something that you considered? Is it something going forward that you'd consider?
No, it's not something that we considered or even today would consider. We still have a lot of technology risk as well as execution risk after we figure out all the technology. So it's not something we'd be comfortable with. You know, the risk involved, this is what our venture capitalists know and are familiar with. I think it would be hard to get a crowd-funded project to understand that risk. Yeah. But if it's a positive later stage project and positive cash flows from that power project, sure, I could treat them like any other investor.
We'd use it at the solar business I'm involved with. We acquire solar projects and we'd use it, and we've talked to all of them, but it's not large enough yet, really. It's better for small projects. And I think what you'll probably see happen in the next year or so, which SolarCity has started it, and these commercial solar companies with yield codes are extending, is that sooner or later, whether it's solar or storage or wind or natural gas, these project-based entities will get access to public capital. And then if I'm an investor and I can make a yield in my IRA, let's say, you know, a long-term solar portfolio or wind portfolio, I'm probably going to opt for that public investment as opposed to a crowdsourced one, because the crowdsourced one, you really are in it for 15 to 20 years, and there's probably not a liquid market to sell it if you want to or you need to. But once the other portfolios get into the public market, it's a great option. It's a higher yield than you're going to get elsewhere. They tend to be relatively low risk. And if you can sell them, it's a great option. So I think when that happens, crowdsourcing will probably find a niche that they can address.
Okay.
So Dan,
go ahead.
Dan, you mentioned letting utilities compete in the transportation space. What might that look like?
Well, there's a number of different theories that have been offered up. It's everything from leasing the battery, owning the battery, and then when its useful life as a source of transportation energy is expired, put it on the grid for grid backup. Obviously, natural gas infrastructure into the home is a major piece of making natural gas more prevalent in the transportation sector. It's not the perfect solution given greenhouse gas emissions, but it's certainly better than oil or traditional petroleum. Hydrogen fueling infrastructure. I'm thinking of a range of ways in which the utilities understand consumer behavior and consumer need and have the level of consumer trust that we heard about this morning, and can do what they do well, which is building distribution level infrastructure to provide energy services to consumers at the point of demand. In this case, it's a combination of electrons, potentially hydrogen, natural gas, and things we haven't envisioned yet. But really utilizing their capital base, the regulatory compact, it says we'll give you market access in exchange for performing against a public mandate, and you've got the workforce. That's a much better combination to me to get meaningful traction in the near term than expecting startups, despite their entrepreneurial energy, to go against this massive incumbency.
Hi, Craig Lewis with Clean Coalition. Going back to the concept of fractional ownership or getting ownership out to a broader base of investors, it seems to me that the real bottleneck is in the tax equity layer. So how is that being addressed in both the yieldcos and crowdsourcing and other fractional ownership opportunities where we can get people who have tax appetite, individuals, get their money in this game and get them in that layer that is actually the big bottleneck in the renewable energy investment space?
I can take a shot.
Another big question.
I'm sure you have a
tax equity is a constraint, much less so than it used to be. There's a lot more knowledgeable financial institutions willing to invest in clean technology. It's still slow, it's still cumbersome, it's still very expensive, and there's very few corporate entities that are joining. Google is a great example of one that has joined and has a significant presence, and if there were 100 other Google type investors, our problems would probably be solved. I don't know, quite honestly, how you ever get it to the individual level. And in the case of solar, the ITC is going from 30 to 10 in 2016, so it becomes less of a problem. But it's tricky on the individual side, both because of existing regulations, but also the tax equity requires a lot of lawyering, and doing anything smaller than, say, a $20 million financing, you tend to lose all of the economics. And so I honestly don't know how you solve that one.
Well, just to kind of add on, for fossil investments, are excluded from the tax limitations, right, through federal tax law. So
right.
With one line of code change, if this industry got really motivated,
yep,
rather than fighting for an MLP,
yep,
just fighting for tax equity equal treatment,
yep,
with fossil would do the job.
And I spent 3 years of my life trying to get one line changed, and I don't know how you do that. I honestly don't. To go to the Treasury today and say, give us another loophole, it's tough. It's really tough.
Yeah, we broke our pick on the REIT question, and we got a really narrow ruling, basically worthless from my perspective. The MLP Parity Act is a one-line change. We can't get that.
Yep.
In a normal Congress, or at least a reasonably functional Congress, all these things would be possible. We also spent a lot of time trying to figure out how to do a multi-investor tax equity fund, which in concept seems fine, but what you wind up with is corporate level buy-in, and then the senior treasury officer who only sees downside.
Yeah.
Nobody wants to give up their tax management because all they do is get burned if something goes wrong. There's no incentive mechanism for them. So for an entity like a community solar or a yield company, they have to source the tax equity in a traditional way and hold a large bucket of tax equity against a bunch of small projects standardized enough so that their tax equity investor feels comfortable,
yeah,
and then go and source the other forms of capital from the crowd. It's doable. You're seeing it. But it's a really heavy lift, and there are many nights when I just wish that the tax equity thing would go away and we could figure out how to be a mature industry without
yep.
it.
Let me ask a follow-up question on that, because in other sectors, and I'm thinking of affordable housing, there are obligations under the Community Reinvestment Act, for example, for banks to do a certain amount of affordable housing. One of the ways that they do that voluntarily, but it's an option, is to provide tax equity in affordable housing. Are there similar ways that not, you know, for companies that are, you know, that we've seen the buyer's principles come out from the Group of 12 and other places, are there places where you might see companies sort of on a voluntary basis say, this is one of the ways that we can meet our sustainability goals, sort of following the model that the banks use under the CRA? Or is that just as heavy a lift and there are places where you can get more bang for the buck and more juice from the squeeze?
The CRA, you run the risk of picking a fight with the CRA community, which needs those still relatively scarce dollars for their own projects. So you have to expand the pie before you try and cut a piece of it off for yourself. A good example, though, where there is some interesting traction is in the green bond principles, which is getting a lot of traction. Anytime a green bond is issued around the world, it's oversubscribed. So that just goes to the underlying nature of the project. Once the projects are viable, the cash flows are steady, and people understand the technologies, you can package it in traditional capital markets, debt market fashion. And we're going to see a lot of growth there. It's not good for innovation on its own, but it creates the end state into which innovative projects mature, and that will lead to more venture capital forming as a result.
Thank you very much. I want to take it back to the policy side a little bit more, because you need to have predictable long-term policies in order to have successful programs. Everybody touched on it. And you need to be able to fall into the buckets as well, because there's lots of technologies that are neither fish nor fowl and don't fit into the categories. How important is it, in your opinion, to have a long-term view with a long-term goal, be that 2030, 2050, with specific milestones that people know need to be achieved and they're predictable, so that the incumbents can play in that territory, whether they're going to lobby to be able to be involved in the transportation sector as fuel providers, as charging station providers, and be able to actually utilize all the resources that they have, or whether it's the renewable resources that need to be coming in online if we're going to have an ever greener grid, and we're getting ready for a greener grid, but we don't have a milestone beyond the 33%. We know it's a floor and not a ceiling, but how important is it to have that predictability for everybody to be able to line their ducks in a row, have the cross sections between industries, transportation, building sector, renewable energy, traditional utilities, and the grid, and then the balancing markets that we have as well to be able to operate much more efficiently. It seems to me that if we don't have that really long-term goal and vision, it's going to be very difficult to be able to make those decisions and plans, and then the investment community coming in with a predictable plan for low-cost financing, because they know what's going on. So I know it's a long question, but...
It's a good question. Who wants it?
I'm happy to take a shot. I don't want to talk too much, but it's essential. You know it's essential. You're a leader in the conversation, so thank you for it. But I would just offer, in addition to, I think, the insights that we would all agree with, in some respects, 2030 is more important than 2050. Because 2050, for us who are fully committed to this and understand the exogenous maturation of this industry, seems important, but for traditional investors, that's it beyond their lifetime for most of these folks. What they want to know is what happens after 2020, which is basically around the corner. And it's not just a general statement of principles in the form of an executive order. It's got to get down to the way that the 70-odd programs under AB 32 are stretched out for another 10 years, and then another 10 years after that, specific targets, specific public investment strategies alongside it. This will remain a public-private partnership through the duration of this transformation, but we have to get that midterm target really cemented, even as we continue to hold fast to the 2050 long-term vision.
I think we've got time for one more. Oh, we've got 10 minutes. Oh, excellent.
We're running 10 minutes.
There's got to be another answer to that question.
No, that's perfect. Yeah.
I think as an investor, the longer the better, right? And Dan's right. You need intermediate steps. So one goal that's 50 years out isn't as helpful as 10 5-year goals, let's say. But I think the goal is to get these industries to the point where they can survive on their own. So in solar, I don't worry too much about what the 2030 goal is. I probably shouldn't say that, Graham, sorry, or the 2050 goal. Because it's already at the point where the momentum's unstoppable. It's becoming cheaper than other sources. It's accepted. The financing community is interested in it. So I don't really worry about it anymore. It's going to get there. But you've got other technologies. I don't know what Adam's technology is, but his technology.
It's essential.
And, it's absolutely essential. So I think it's important to stage these things and have your goal be get it to a point where the costs are going to come down so that it can survive on its own. And I think you'll get some more broad support. In the early days of solar, the people that were really against solar were the ones that thought, oh, this is just a waste of government money. And I kept saying, no, it's an investment that's going to drive the industry, the sustainability. And I think as long as that's part of the long-term goal, you'll get a lot of support.
From the agency perspective, as a director, are you looking out? Some of it is at the whims of annual legislative appropriations. I know how fun those are.
Oh yeah, no, there's a very active conversation happening between all the energy agencies and the governor's office on this. And one other point I would make, why I think it's important to have a hard target that's bold for 2030. Is that it actually moves the needle in other states. And if you look at what's happened, for example, with net metering policy, created here in California in 1995, it spread to 44 states. The RPS, born here again in 19 states. Other states look to us, and then as those markets grow, that helps bring down the cost for the clean energy technology. If we're just doing this alone, we're in a disadvantage. I think having a firm policy actually becomes contagious and to our benefit. So I think it's another reason to do it.
Yeah,
point taken.
Adam, when you're looking at it, and I know that you've got some concerns at the federal level too. But as you're looking at investment decisions and how you're scaling your company, what is the role of long-term policy there?
It is very large. So as a company and our investors, we're always looking at the highest risk, whether it's technology or execution. And unfortunately, regulatory issues are high on execution risk. So when we're looking at building a manufacturing plant, we have to look at what state can we do the most business in based on the regulatory framework. So it plays a huge role for us making business decisions. And as we grow and our valuations get higher, we're bringing in later stage investors, they're going to be more concerned about that and often less familiar. So the more clarity we have in regulatory issues, the easier it is for us to grow. It just adds more risk to any project.
So as I've been listening, it seems to me, both with this panel where we've been hearing about technology and how to move technology through the commercialization stream and get funding and demands for it, it's understandable the challenges of how to let technology play. This morning, when Al Plasky was talking, we heard more about an information solution, how to sort of garner information to bring to bear to modify the way people use energy. And I'm struck by the fact that there's a gray zone in the middle. I'll use energy efficiency as an example, since I spent a lot of my time on that. But where I think the innovations are not only on technology and information, but also we need innovation on business models to bring solutions for complex sets of technologies that need to be put together and integrated into systems and new ways of financing and making money. And I don't think we're getting traction there the way we are with some of the technologies. And since this is sort of a business investment-oriented panel, I would say, what do you think are the government ought to be doing differently in order to look at that middle ground for when we need systems integration solutions as opposed to a new technology or a new big data report?
David, you know something about business model innovation?
Well, I would be more specific. I think we need innovation in utility business models in particular. I think that's, in a way, the main crux of the issue. And if you have an incumbent utility that does not see any way to proceed profitably except by fighting the next wave of clean energy, that's just not very productive. And one of the things, Dan, you touched on, the prospect of utilities getting into clean energy, clean transportation infrastructure. I think there's a whole pathway there. There's been, if you look at just all the changes happened in technology and then ask, how have utilities changed? It's amazing. On one hand, you have all this activity and O-Power and, a zillion other companies coming with new technologies. and then the utility business model is fundamentally unchanged, you know, in many ways. And so I think it's actually, my view is that that's actually where the real innovation is needed. The rest, I think, will sort out. I think, you know, there have been some good partnerships developed. I mean, you can say more. You're in the space right now. I mean,
yeah, I think that's a great point about utility transformation. They are fighting to keep their fixed asset base and help that grow, but they're also not allowed to own, or they can, but it's a very long and arduous process to own generating assets. So if we allow them to own assets or provide some sort of debt funding to customers that want to own these assets, they have a very cheap capital. So if we allow that cheap capital to get in the market, I mean, that's one way that the utilities would not only get more technologies out there, but also reduce their own barriers for getting those technologies out there.
David, did you want to touch on this? You've done so. I mean, people told you were crazy when you tried to sell solar as a service.
Right.
And
energy efficiency is a tough one. I've looked at that, not recently, but maybe 5-6 years ago, I looked pretty hard at it. And one of the problems is you're trying to finance potential savings. And going to a financial institution and saying, finance my potential savings, is a pretty short conversation, unfortunately. So somehow you have to turn it into a certainty so that they're willing to finance it. And the idea about having utilities provide that financing is a great one, but there's an inherent conflict. For every kilowatt hour you save through energy efficiency, that's less revenue to the utility. And so I don't have a great answer for you, unfortunately, but we were talking about this last night. It's still, there's so much low-hanging fruit in energy efficiency that hopefully someone will start solving that problem.
I think there's some conceptual designs at the regulatory level that could work to incent the utility to embrace energy efficiency if you can reward them for the outcomes.
Right.
These are academic concepts, but they show up, I think, increasingly in the UK and the Rio, and maybe in New York, and partly in California with the utility shareholder incentive mechanism, although it's too small and sporadic and argued about after the fact. A main challenge is in customer acquisition. So you can have your business model innovation, and once you get to the customer, what's the cost of the customer of saying yes to efficiency? That's the solar efficiency as a service. Got an idea about how to do that, but it still costs too much to go to the small commercial and residential customers, figure out what they need, and make it easy for them to say yes, literally get the decision maker to a point where they can say yes. That disrupts the economics of an ESCO or a fund that wants to do efficiency. So what's the role of a public intervention in that regard? ECO is great, 1% capital for efficiency in public buildings. Why not private buildings? Why not give that 1% capital to ESCOs that are going to go and get these challenging markets, driving down their cost of customer acquisition, and then have them provide the 0% financing to the customer once they do say yes. The challenge is in literally the truck roll and the cost of getting to an affirmation from a potential customer.
It's interesting you say that, because we've spent so much time nationally with SunShot and everything else talking about driving down the soft cost of solar,
right.
And you're basically talking about the soft cost of efficiency,
right. Mm-hmm.
And how you get there. Mm-hmm. One more?
No,
all right. Very good. Well, this has been a great panel, and I really appreciate each of you for participating and for all of you for being here asking such great questions. And I think we were told that we had to come up with solutions and not just have a conversation, and I think we at least pointed the way towards that. But I encourage you to use the rest of today and indeed going forward to pursue some of those solutions and onward. Thanks very much.
All right. Thank you.